thank you all for joining. I think it's really cool to be building this community of people that obviously you highly value this discussion. And I am not the only person that's talking about it. I love seeing that people have realized in their own experience that although there are details to our lives that make us more effective, that we need to know, right? There's information, there's knowledge, skill that comes as a result of that. But there's also something beyond it, which is our emotional welling up as a result of thoughts that we've had. And that's big. That's really, really big. And it's something we're going to come back around to a lot, is this sort of separation of our thoughts that occur to us that we define as real and thoughts that are bigger than the thoughts that are sort of passing through, like on our Facebook feed, that are a reflection of our true intention in life, our true identity, what we really want to achieve. So the stuff that spins past our frame can be things that are not true about ourselves, not true about the world, and blow things out of proportion to the point where we get afraid because what we are doing is assigning truth to something that may not be partially or completely true. So let's get started here with the first really, really good question from Tim. I love it. And it's something that many, many people, probably everybody is my guess, recognized, is that when you have an accident, right? So I'll read the question directly. You run into problems coming back, getting back on the horse. So Brian, my question pertains to a recent accident I had on the canopy portion of the skydive. I foolishly and aggressively turned to avoid an obstacle and caused my canopy to dive at under 300 feet above the ground. I slammed in and broke my back and butt. Sorry to hear that. That sucks. 5 months have passed and recovery's going very well, but I still have issues which prevent me from jumping this season if they don't correct themselves, but I'm eager to get back in the harness and jump again. My question is this: how does one get the harness back on and overcome the dread of what if? Huge. Well worded. Thank you. Especially when the first accident was so traumatic. And he goes on to state something which I think is really beautiful. He says, skydiving brought a sense of immense joy to my life, and I do not want to lose it. And your knowledge, Tim, and anybody else that's going through this same thing or has gone through it, your knowledge of your love of the sport, you know, is the meaning that drives you forward, right? What creates the ability to plow through these big barriers is a mass of consciousness. If you were driving a small car and trying to bust through a fence, you might get through it, you might bounce off the fence, but if you're driving a big heavy truck, there is more mass to push through it, and your intention is the mass, right? And so your will is built up as you nurture thoughts about how much you love it, and you elaborate. You elaborate, why do you want to do it? Because when you're in the door of the plane the first time after an accident, and I can speak to this because I've been there after spending a long time in a wheelchair, you're going to have question marks and you're going to have yeah buts. You know what I mean when I say yeah but, right? So I'm going to have to fight back against those yeah buts, those question marks that are going to market themselves as sanity, right? Rational. Hey, we got to be, you know, in reality here. I can't, right? Justification of limitation. I need to fight back with meaning. I need to fight back with a deeper purpose. And if it's just something as bare as I need to prove to myself that I can, this is a good starting place. If it's valid for you, it's good. If it's from a place of lack, because you don't feel like you can, you don't even quite believe you can, but you're going to try to make it through the experience and hopefully get to the other side, I think you should search for a little more. a little bit more about what you love about the sport. And more importantly, I would go deeper. What do you love about who you are being when you're skydiving, right? If it was a skiing accident, what do you love about who you're being when you're skiing? And not just the skiing activity, but the whole thing, right? So when I'm skydiving, I mean, I define driving to the drop zone as skydiving. You know, that's part of it. When I'm hanging at the campfire, that's part of skydiving. What do I love about my persona, the shift, and what it brings out in terms of my true nature, right? Who I really am. Personally, I just love how people get to be themselves, you know, really be themselves on the drop zone. But there's more than that. And so I urge you to dig deeper into that. I also find that to creep back towards the edge of something that is a little bit scary, maybe a lot of bit scary, we have to do it incrementally. And so you take it piece by piece. You have to put together this kind of holistic experience of the skydiver, component by component. You have a gear component. Get current with your gear. You don't have to jump it to get current with it. Play with it. Pull it out. Pack the parachute if you can. Put it on as you're sitting on the couch watching TV. Touch your handles. Make it a part of your body. And I think that there's nothing wrong with this, you know, it's kind of awkward for some people, but, you know, this spending the time to fall back in love with the equipment and sort of own it. Maybe it looks weird to your neighbors as they look through the window, but who cares, right? I mean, they already think you're weird. You're a skydiver. Get used to it, right? So consider another possibility is that if you have some way to hang yourself up in your gear, ideally in your jumpsuit, heck, put on your helmet, make it as real as you can. I have a chin-up bar. That's what I use. I've got a set of risers. I connect an old set of risers, you know, with the tops of the risers connected together by a soft link. Not the soft link that Aerodyne makes because it is a metal ring. I like the soft one. And I go up over the chin-up bar, and that does a couple things. One is I can set that up and just hang and get used to the feeling on my legs, build up the physical capacity to hang in the harness for a while, right? You're probably going to pull high on your first jump back. Don't you want to be comfortable? Work towards that, right? Get in the harness, get comfortable. Maybe, you know, maybe have a blower. That's what I have. I've got a big carpet blower. Some people call it a snail blower. Huge thing that I angle upward at the angle of the relative wind roughly. And I hang in the harness, and I do this with my kids. I do it with my wife. I do it with my wingsuit students. You hang up and you get used to the feeling of the wind and just grow accustomed to it. I even started to do it with wind tunnel students who have never flown before. I just angle it straight up and they get used to the feeling of the wind. And then when you're finally exposed to this, you've been creeping your way towards the experience instead of trying to go from the couch, you know what I mean? Woofo status, woofo mind, to leaping all the way over to being a skydiver. Well, I know how to do this, I'll be fine. And then you're in the airplane with your heart in your throat, just trying to remember where your handles are. You've been living your skydiving life in your mind and in your body, right? You're creeping back towards that thing. So we call this systematic desensitization, right? So you're desensitizing yourself to the provocative stimulus. And you go, okay, let's talk specifically. Tim turned low and whacked himself. I've done it too. I'm willing to bet that a lot of people have done the same thing. So how do I take a really focused look on what am I afraid of, right? I'm first going to accept that I am afraid. That's step one. But step two has to be to sort of become clarified in what it is that is provoking my fear specifically. Is it the mental imagery? Probably. A lot of them have this, you know, this visual memory that repeats like a movie that just keeps replaying of the ground coming up. There it comes again, and the feeling of helplessness to prevent it, right? So you look at that experience and you allow the experience as it is, and you don't fight off the emotion right off the bat. You accept it. You go, yep, that's how I feel when I see that. You know what? That's sane to see a planet racing up at you and you can't stop it from hitting you. It is sane to have that response. Nevertheless, if you can add to that visualization something new. So for instance, if you can change the way your body feels before you allow that visualization, which brings me to a whole other aspect of this topic, which is adding awareness to your own consciousness, right? Adding awareness of the present moment, of your thoughts, of the truth of what is, the truth of the right now. And one of the problems that we deal with, and it could be one of the reasons why our people, not just the skydivers, but our people as a whole, suffer from a wide variety of traumas, is that we have trouble stopping the repeating imagery because we are observers. Our culture creates observers because we watch the world through TV, through our phones, through our computers. Even in school, we're trained to sit down and shut up, right? We're not training leaders in school. We're training followers. We're training people to be quiet, not interact, and not feel powerful, because we want the power at the front of the classroom with the teacher or the leader, right, in general. And that is obviously not the healthiest way to operate a brain, to operate a mind that is going to throw things at you that you want to stop, right? You want to say, you're not valid around, you know, visualization coming up at me. I did experience it. It was valid at the time, but the past is not the present, right? And to cut that past away, we have to get control over our minds. And so I'm going to do a little experiment with you here. Probably familiar with these things. I want you to just pay attention to the sound, really focus, and I have no clue how well this is going to come through on my microphone, but pay attention to the sound, sit still as you do, be completely mindful, that's the right word, I think, and listen into the distance of the sound. As it fades, then I want you to just focus out beyond it, beyond the sound, into the whole of your reality. The whole of your right now moment, wherever you're sitting, right? Okay, I'm gonna do it with you. What does it feel like to tune out the world and tune into the real world? You know, we have a noisy reality. And some of the noises come from within us. As a matter of fact, a lot of them come from within us. And so when we're dealing with intense sort of repetitive trauma that we're doing to ourselves with our visualizations, with our minds, with our recreation, our post-traumatic stress disorder, is what the right term is, we are allowing something to continue because we feel like a victim of our own thoughts, because we think those thoughts are our thoughts. Ego, right? I exist. I'm real. I think, therefore I am. And I say, no, I think, therefore I am not really in the world. Because when I think, I'm retreating away from the world. And so if I can focus on something like a sound, like the sound of a babbling brook, like the sound of silence or wind through the trees, and I spend that effort towards commanding my consciousness to collect into this moment as a singular point of awareness, then when I find myself in a situation where my thoughts are bringing me down, my thoughts are bringing me away from the possibility of a brilliant expression of my intention, brilliant sort of carrying out of my skill in this moment that I've rehearsed, I've trained, and I get up on the stage and I blow it because I'm in here instead of really in this moment. This is the heart of the problem, is it not? So the other aspects to consider, and Tim and I discussed this a little bit before, is that if you ran into the ground from a low turn in skydiving, you have to also address the behavior patterns, the skill and knowledge that's going to lead you to be in a similar circumstances and have a different outcome. So the ability to dig yourself out of a turn is a skill, and it's something that you can practice. It's something you can become a badass at, right? You can be really good at bailing out of a low turn, a digging ninja. And if you do that, if you rehearse the solutions, if you sort of earn your trust in yourself that when you're in that circumstance, number one, you're going to recognize the problem because you're noticing where you're moving to earlier. You're not maybe focusing straight down. You're looking out at an angle, which gives you more three-dimensional information about your descent rate and your direction of motion. And you see that problem earlier. Knowing that you're going to see it earlier is going to make you feel better. To rehearse the spike of the brakes, hitting the brakes early enough that you are not even dealing with the roll axis yet. You're just bumping the brakes wherever you are, right? It's like taking a deep breath wherever you are. I know you want to say something. I know it's important. I know it's a burning passion, but take a deep breath so you don't blow it, so you don't ruin the execution of your intention and create secondary explosions as a result of your unskillful means of carrying out your intention. This is not an easy thing to do, but it's the most important thing to do, to be able to operate in the hot kitchen and still cook a beautiful meal. The ability to calm the mind, clarify the intention, it takes time. It's not something you just say, I'm enlightened. There's work involved. And it's not hard work, but it does take time. And what I recommend, because it's what I personally done and it works for me, is I start in the morning when I haven't just watched a movie that's filled my brain with visualizations. I might have had dreams, but when I awake, if I can clear those dreams away and really be in bare attention of the morning light, you know, of the openness of the day, the wide openness of the now, I'm capable of seeing my world as it really is. We're projectors. Most of the time, human beings are not seeing the world as it is. We're seeing it as we are. Am I right? So therefore, we are benefited in tremendous variety of ways when we decide that contemplative practice is part of our skydiving practice. If you decide that you don't just want to be a safe skydiver, that you want to be an amazing skydiver, you want to be the best skydiver that you are capable of being and reap the benefits in terms of safety, but also the benefits of expanded joy because you have more skill, right? Skill brings more out. If you're a decent ice skater, you can only do so much, but if you're a really good ice skater, I mean, you're going to have more fun because of your skill. If that is your goal, if that is your asserted intention, that is an ongoing intention, then you have to take a look at the observer of this, right? The mind of this. Are you a cloudy sort of looking glass into the world, or are you repeatedly clearing yourself off? You know, so that's, I think, Tim, that's a piece of this puzzle, but there's much, much more to talk about. But let's move on to the next question. Paul says, I'm currently afraid of the political events that are transpiring. You're not the only one. I know I shouldn't worry about things I can't control. Stop you there for a second. Don't should on yourself. Doesn't help, right? There's no should. There's no shouldn't. It is. Accept it as it is, and then move forward. Do you agree? Yes. But I'm afraid of the things the president, is going to create, things outside of our control that will affect us in a very negative way. I can't stop reading the news, and it makes me very afraid. And Paul, you are speaking for millions of people. There's also another group of people, possibly a shrinking group of people, but a large group of people who are not afraid because of political stuff. They're finally getting what they believe is right. And for the past 8 years, they've been afraid because they thought that things were going to happen outside of their preferences, right? So I think it's very important for us to have compassion for the, quote, other side that is also a piece of humanity, a piece of America, a piece of the collective human consciousness. So what do you do when you're afraid of something that you don't feel in control of? That's one of the best questions ever. Because many of the things in life are beyond our control, the things that we're afraid of. There are some things that are within our control, and we must sort of flex our muscle in all the ways that we can to work towards reducing risks, to creating a world in your little way that is moving in a direction that feels saner and safer for you. That said, you're not going to move mountains with your mind instantaneously. So what do you do? Fear is local, right? We say, oh, everybody's afraid. So many people are afraid. And yeah, you can measure it. There's, you know, the Schumann resonance. There's ways to look at the global vibe, if you will. And that is a valid frequency that we have to recognize is there. But when you come right down to it, the source of fear is you. The source of fear is not in the news. The source of fear is not the ground coming up at you when you're hooking low, or when you pull low and you're staring at the ground, or when you jump off of a bridge at New River and you're, you know, feeling it. But we blame our circumstances as the source of our fear, and therefore we take away our own internal locus of control. We blame the world for making us feel that way. Some of you have probably been in long-term relationships. And some of you have been in that moment where somebody says, you made me so mad. And you say, hey, I didn't make you mad. You made you mad. You let yourself get mad. Which is a nice way to throw gasoline on the fire and find yourself in a much longer and louder argument. But the truth of the matter is, yeah, we allow it. We allow the fear within ourselves. And that's a choice. It's a choice to keep on spinning the wheel of the visualization of what we don't want, keep looking for things that make us afraid, right? If you're looking in the news for happy stories, you're going to find that and you're going to feel better. And if you're going to look in the stories for reasons why you feel disempowered, why the sky is falling, you become Chicken Little. And I'm not saying there isn't reason to be active. There isn't reason to engage the government, to engage USPA, right, to engage your neighborhood community in things that need to change, because there's a lot about this world that needs to change and improve, right? We take what is, and then we leverage that, the knowledge of that, and we move forward. We make it better. However, doesn't mean we have to get scared. It doesn't mean that our fear is invalid. It's real. It's natural. It's human. But it's not helpful. It's not helpful because it disempowers us. Fear takes away your sense of, yes, I can handle this. So what do you do then? How do you clear yourself? That's the next question, right? So for instance, if I'm going to give a talk in front of a large group, which I do quite a lot of, and I've been doing that for many years, and I love doing it. Not saying I don't get afraid, but what I try to do, mostly successfully, is keep my feeling based on my choice about how I want to feel, which is based on what I know is going to give me the optimum level of performance. And there's a lot out there that's going to try to throw you off, right? If you get up in the morning, you decide, I want to feel love, and you walk into the world and you see some violent program, or you see somebody playing Grand Theft Auto, or you hear an explosion or a siren, or you read the news, and all of this is trying to shake the boat. What I'm saying is your boat isn't actually in the ocean. We believe it's in the ocean. We believe our thoughts are thinking us, that our thoughts are creating our physiological emotional experience, and it makes it true, but it's not actually true. It's an assumption. The ego wants to believe it's true, and it wants to believe everything it says, every thought that it has, is reality. But reality is not as simple as it sounds. And from another perspective, it's much simpler than it sounds, because if you take away the idea that my thoughts are the thoughts and they are the true thoughts, and I separate and go, they're just thoughts, and I don't have to believe in them. I have to believe what feels right in my heart. That changes it. That allows you to take a kite and release the string from the ground and let it fly away. But holding it down to this assumption that I'm valid in my fear and I have no choice about whether I get afraid or not when I read the news, when I ponder politics, then I am no longer powerful. So I have a reason to calm down, to clarify my intention, and to reach for the best feeling I can reach for right now. A little bit better, a little bit better. So talking about getting on the stage for me, I lock myself in the bathroom. I mean, I don't necessarily lock the door, but most of the time it's like I'm in a stall, in a bathroom that has multiple stalls. And, you know, if there's a green room, great, I'll go to the green room, maybe light some incense, light some sage, whatever, clarify that space. But if all I can do is just sit down, slow my breathing, listen to the sound of nothing, not just for 2 seconds, but for as long as I have, so I can filter it out. And that word filter is important, because filter says I can create a bubble around me where my mood is my choice. That's power. And it is a choice. It is a freedom that you have. We're all born with it. We're born with free will to act in the way that we choose. And we're born with free will to think in the way that we choose. We think our thoughts are something we're not responsible for, that only our actions are what we're responsible for. And that is a formula for your thoughts getting the best of you. And then you find yourself powerless. And you read the news and you go, oh my God, and I do it too. Laura, did you see this? You know, look what happened this time. You know, so we got another reason to sign another petition or stand up and call a congressman or do something. And all the while, we are, you know, collectively steering this ship with our democracy, right? But nevertheless, a group of individuals that feel disempowered because of the shock and awe of the system, it's going to lead us in this direction of not speaking up, not standing up. The fear mutes you. It mutes your intention. And it mutes your mind and the thoughts that can come that says, no, I have the ability to make myself feel better. I have the ability to put a bubble around myself. So other things that are helpful along these lines for me, here's a ritual. I think anybody can do it if you have a bathtub, is you run a hot bath. I do it as hot as I can take it. And I put a lot of Epsom salts in there, like a lot, like a cup or two. A lot, usually closer to 2 cups. I light candles. I burn my sage. I might put on chill music. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. And I get in there with the candles burning, I turn out the lights, and I just sit there. And when you consider the electrical impulses in the human body, right, that's the neurological network that makes up your consciousness, contained in your body, that part of your consciousness, it is electrical. And when you consider what salt water does in terms of electricity, right, it conducts electricity. And when you see things in the world and you have emotional reactions, you pick up other people's vibes and thoughts and anger and fear, and it gets on you like a teacher that comes back from school and they got chalk all over their clothes from writing on the chalkboard, you got to clean it off. And the visualizations you've had in the past for bad experiences, all of this stuff, you got to clean it off again and again and again. Clear it off. There's all kinds of ways to do that. There's Reiki rituals for how to clear that stuff. From the top down, clearing your chakras, they call that. everybody's different in where you come into this. Some of this sounds way woo-woo, you know, way outside the box, very, very new agey. Start where you are, pick up with what makes sense to you. If the idea of taking a walk in nature and listening to nature is sufficient for you, and that's as far as you're willing to go right now with this stuff, take a walk in nature and really listen. Sit down on a rock and observe nature. This is a mindfulness practice. You let it go and you get good at letting go. And sometimes you can't let go because the thought that you have is, it's 2,000 feet and I'm in free fall. Okay, calm down, relax, focus, flow, do it right. Slow is fast. We know this stuff. Rushing makes a big mess of things anyway. So do it in a contemplative manner, right? Do it in a mindful manner, without rushing, without panic, without the amygdala, the hypothalamus, the limbic system triggering you this wave of insanity, the brain on fire, as I called it in the new article in the blog. You might want to check that out on adventurewisdom.com. I like how that one came out. So hopefully, Paul, this is going to give you some food for thought in the ways that you can insulate yourself into a place of security of your own mood, building off of that, expanding it, and creating a reality of your own where you are stable. And then from that place, you look upon the world and you take on the fights that need to be taken, but you do it in a way that is larger, right? A larger version of you that is sort of comfortable in your power, not feeling like you're backpedaling through it. The whole world is coming down. The sky is not falling. We have issues. We always had issues. That's not new. So the issue right now is a lot of America is freaked out, and that's the problem. There are other problems that are causing people to be freaked out, but it's the response to the problem that needs to be addressed if the true power is going to come forth. Okay, so next question. Now, MJ had a really nice little drop in. She didn't have a specific question, but what she did say, I think, is worth offering. She says, all I know about fear is breathe. And then pull up those big girl pants. Which is adorable. Yeah. Yeah. We do have to decide to stand up in a place of groundedness, in a place of focus, and take the breath and go forward anyway. Sometimes forward is backwards, but that's just a 180 with forward progress. Sometimes you look at a situation and go, I can't win this one. Calm down, clear your head, and go where you need to go. Track off, cut away, walk away from a party where people are starting to throw bottles, right? Or a march where you see people are starting to get angry. Leave, but don't run, walk, right? Calm down, breathe, and do what you got to do. And she added another really good thing is, there's no fear but fear itself, and I agree completely. There's no fear but the fear itself. There are causes for concern. Shall we? Right? Let's dig just a little bit deeper into this idea, the distinction between what I call fear and caution. To me, fear is all of these negative worldviews and negative actions that are sort of based on a place of lack. The opposite of abundance, the opposite of abundance of solutions or resources or answers to whatever is going on right there, right now, that thing that's got my panties in a bunch. When I let the alarm cause me to run and panic, I lose control. I lose control of the situation because I lost control of me. So that ability to absorb the shock, right? To kind of go with it, accept the physiological change that happened to your body and go, right? The om, right? Bring it back because the intention remains at all times. Notice it, be with it, accept it. Don't hate yourself for being afraid or pissed off. Go, yep, that's how I feel. What's at the core of this? not the secondary explosions, not the emotional response. What's at the core of this in terms of the meaning? What is my fear trying to tell me? What is my anger trying to tell me? Now, what do I got to do to carry out solutions to that? There is a place in between the execution of the solution and the realizing of the problem where contemplative mindfulness awareness practice comes in, where compassion for other perspectives comes in. Because I created the space in my meta-level thinking, M-E-T-A, meta-level, the thought about the thought, right? The thought about the thought about the thought, where I'm able to be smarter, wiser, able to see other aspects of this that my initial gut reaction might have, you know, not seen. This is the trouble with reactive action. I see a post, it inflames me, and I share it. What if it wasn't true? What if it was fake news coming out of Eastern Europe or Eastern USA, whatever? Fake news is out there, and it's out there because we are sharing it without exploring multiple sources. The calming down and the centering, the recognition that yes, this created an emotional response because there is a great meaning within this for me, but I might be wrong. They might be playing me, right? The world is playing us. If you feel out of whack because of the political events, the world is playing you. You're being put into a place of get back in the kitchen and cook me some dinner, right? We're being put into a place where the people that want our money, the corporations that want our money, the government that wants maybe us to sit down and shut up, is gonna create shock and awe, right? The media wants us to be fascinated with the story, so we stick around for the commercial to watch the violent programming because we wanna kill that bad guy in the story. We're better than that, aren't we? I choose to be. I'm not succeeding every day, every moment, but I'm trying. Maybe you guys are too. So next thoughts that we have coming in. Now, Tim had a follow-up question, which I'm going to share as well. He says, firstly, thank you. You've given me some fantastic things to think about before I get going. Before I get going again, as soon as my gear returns from the rigor, I will getting to know it like I have never known it before. Yeah. Secondly, I can appreciate the mental mindset in getting to a healthy point in my mind before I throw myself back out that door again and having it overwhelm the crap out of me. I know the moment I land on my feet again, that rush of pure adrenaline will return like it always has. And the moment I touch the ground, I will realize what I have accomplished. Thank you. I look forward to talking with you in the future. This is exactly the direction of thought that's going to get you back on the horse. So we have to just simply recognize when the thoughts are leading away from our skydiverhood, you know, our power, our feeling of joy, of celebration, right? Of happiness. We have thoughts that say, yeah, but here's why I can't. And then there's thoughts that justify the opposite. And it is a choice which way we go. People think they're not in a swivel chair. You're in a swivel chair. And it's a 360-degree set of options where you can say, all right, so what do you got? Thought. Not my thought, just a thought. How does that feel? Not very good. Next. And we turn our heads towards something else. And we see how that makes us feel. Because we have chosen our assignment ahead of time. So I sit down with my boys and I say, all right, let's watch something together on this rainy Saturday morning, right? Sometimes we can go caving or something like that on a Saturday morning instead, but there's times when we sit down in front of the computer and we say, all right, let's watch a really great nature show. And that's our intention. And we flip through and Matthew says, oh, look, dinosaur train. I said, nope, we're watching a really cool nature show with really beautiful photography. Okay, so what's this one? Joshua says, oh, look, there's Transformers. Nope, that's not what we're doing. So that's what we do with our thoughts. We keep letting them go. And if we do that literally and figuratively, we can choose our experience. And I'm not saying don't watch the news, but watch the news in a different way. I would suggest read the news. It's a little more inert. You have a little more choice in about the way you react, because quite frankly, if you watch some of the people on the news now, they are not trying to calm you down. Many of them are literally trying to excite you into a froth. And if you don't want to be in that state of mind, maybe read the news instead. Consider the possibility also, if it is true, in my experience it is, that our world has stepped up our level of fear, because we're in an unknown place now, right? We have a president that's very different. We've got a sort of relatively uniform Congress and Senate in terms of the power, where things can get pushed through quicker in our, you know, in our worry, we believe all of that's true. May or may not be true. And we have the capability of seeing all that stuff in a way that we just say, what if it's not that bad? What if it's not that bad? What if my slider is going to come down off the canopy and I linger a little bit longer in the hope and I leave the opportunity for that to occur? And if it doesn't occur, I'm ready to come back and act. But I'm going to give life a chance to prove to me that the polar caps aren't going to melt today, that we have a little time to build our electric cars. You know, we might have enough time. Imagine that. Maybe the planet was warming up anyway. Maybe the emissions from cars are enough that we need to deal with that anyway, because people are getting sick from it. How about that? Either way, there is the problem, there is the reaction to the problem, and there is the solution and the antithesis of the solution, which is the emotional, negative emotional reaction that cuts us off from the solution itself, from the skillful execution of the solution. So I'm going to take, there we go. Somebody, Nathan said some really good things here. Thank you, Nathan. He says, I love nature walks, meditation and motion. And that's big, because I agree with you. It's my experience that it's true that meditation doesn't have to be stillness on the outside. It just has to be stillness on the inside, right? My kayak is a meditation machine. Now, when I'm in white water, it's a different kind of a meditation than when I'm on flat water, like early morning with the mist on the flat water that reflects the sky. I'm in a very calm place there, and I get into a rhythm. And there's something about rhythm, right? So when we look at this, the brain states that we call meditation, deafferentation is one of the ways that we describe this. Higher levels and long-term meditators, we experience something called gamma synchrony, where the right and left halves really start to synchronize, and we have increased activity, particularly in the front part of the brain, where our willed action comes from, where our sense of potential for willed action, which I would call power, comes from the front part of the brain. Some might think immediately, third eye, yeah, right? And there's more, right? Because there's compassion that comes from the prefrontal cortex as well, right? The ability to see through other eyes, see through other perspectives, and go bigger. So when we take our meditation to a larger definition, we realize, well, wait a minute, that means I can meditate under canopy. Hell yeah, you can meditate under canopy. You put your parachute into brakes, that helps. It increases the amount of hang time. You relax your muscles as much as you can. You hold yourself still and you look out towards the horizon, which is very healthy for our eyeballs that focus on things this far from us most of the time, right? If we want to, you know, have good eyes and not have to wear glasses all the time, right? We need to get our eyes focused in the distance. But we also need to be able to focus our mind in the two forms of consciousness that the Tibetans call shamatha and vipassana. And it's an important concept, and you can call it whatever you want. You could call it laser beam focus and global awareness. I'm not talking political global awareness. I'm talking about holistic awareness of your entire experience. So as you are, for instance, in free fall, getting ready to dock on a formation, are you only aware of your progress towards the formation? Or are you also noticing the person that's working their way in there also? Are you also noticing the dead spider, the person that went low that's underneath the formation trying to come back up? Do you also notice the wingsuiter that's passing underneath the group? Do you notice what's going on behind your head? That is what we call vipassana. And we get that when we go walk in nature. We get that when we are in meditation with the goal of intense focus on the now in terms of the singularity of it and the singularity of all of it at once. Listening to the birds as you notice the feeling in your body, as you notice the breath. This is mindfulness. And mindfulness has many, many faces. And to change the channel to different mindfulness experiences, I think, is very, very healthy. I've spent time in my life where all I did was sit. I've gone off to the meditation retreats up in the mountains for a month and not talk and just eat vegetarian food and meditate. And yeah, it clears up your vibe really well. It does. But at the end of the day, you come down and you're you again, pretty much. But if there's an everyday practice that has multiple forms, not just the ultimate boredom experience of sitting in actual, you know, traditional meditation, but other things that involve you reaching out particularly into the nature around you, good stuff, right? So go there. All right, I don't see any other here, so I will thank you. Truly, thank you. Not just as me, ego, I need people to show up for my thing. Thank you, fellow humans, for reaching your consciousness towards this question of what is fear and what can I do about it? How can I transmute it? How can I convert it into power and explore the meaning underneath the fear and sweep away the fear itself so that I can be effective in creating all forms of safety, all forms of compassion, all forms of skill in the best way that I possibly can as an individual. And you have a society of individuals that are all moving in that direction. We're going to be fine. Thank you. Thank you all for joining.